Okay. Assalamualaikum and also good morning. Today basically we will talk about the parameter design by root locus. Okay. So far we have learned about how to sketch the root locus. Okay. Of course, the procedure is quite lengthy. Okay. It is taking some time to plot to draw the root locus. And yesterday also I briefly tell you how the application of the root locus basically in design, in deciding the value of the parameter, okay, that we need to choose in our design. Okay, so today we will go in more detail about the parameter design, okay, by using the root locus. So I will explain the utilization of the root locus method for designing and analyzing the parameter of feedback control system. Okay, student will learn the parameter design by root locus method in section 7.4. Okay, of course the knowledge from the previous chapter basically will help you in understanding. Okay. Okay, basically the root locus can display us the effect of varying a parameter. Okay, where when we vary the parameter, the roots will travel, okay, from one place to another place. And basically the root locus is the part of the movement of the proof of the roots when we vary the parameter. Okay. So the root locus method can investigate the effect of varying a parameter to a system, because as we know before that the root location is important in the performance of the feedback control system. Okay. Okay, the only thing when we have the to draw the root locus, as we learned before, we need to rearrange the characteristic equation so that the parameter will become the multiplier. Okay, let's say if we have an equation of the characteristic equation is equal to 1 plus Fs, which is equal to 0. Okay, and let's say the characteristic equation is like this. Okay, from this one basically we get the equation is like this. The only thing we need to rearrange, okay, the parameter of interest will become the multiplier. Okay, for this case, let's say the parameter of interest that we wanted to vary is parameter A1. Okay, so we need to rearrange this equation, okay, so that the A1 will become multiplier. Okay, so basically this one, basically you just need to divide with the rest, this one plus this one plus this one plus this one, except this one, where you get this is equation. Okay. Okay, you divide with that. Okay, the rest will become one, and then this one will become AS divided by all this thing. Okay, once the A1 become multiplier, and then we can use that to sketch the root locus by knowing the poles and also the zeros. Okay, we can start plotting the root locus. Okay, for example, let's say if you have a characteristic equation like this. Okay, let's say currently the parameter that are interest for us, okay, to vary is alpha. Okay, so the only thing you need to rearrange the equation, this equation, so that later on this alpha can become the multiplier like this. Okay, of course this one you can just expand like that, so you have this one, and then this one you need to divide with the rest, okay, so that you have this equation. Okay, And once the alpha already become the multiplier, okay, from here we can maybe you can find the roots, okay, to find the poles, and from here also you can find the roots where you know the zeros, okay, with the poles and zeros that you know, you can start plotting your root locus, okay. So the root locus that you plotted are the root locus showing the movement of the roots when you vary the parameter alpha from 0 until infinity. Okay? So and then you can use, as I mentioned yesterday, okay, you can look at the part of the travel of the alpha of the roots, okay, and you can choose the location of the root on the root locus where it satisfies the specification of your design. Okay, for example, if you want a stable system, okay, you choose the location of the root so that it will stay in the right hand side of the left hand side of the S plane. Okay, and if you know the limit of your damping ratio, okay, for example, you know the maximum percentage of overshoot, you can find the damping ratio, and then you can know where is the angle of the theta. Okay, from there you can and sketch the region where your root should lie. Okay, so choose a point where on the root locus where that roots located in that area. Okay, so if you choose was that particular location of the roots, basically you will find that your system will fulfill the specification. Okay, with the root locus, okay, so far we are talking about utilizing the root locus only for varying one parameter, okay, and it is actually possible also we utilize the root locus to vary two or more parameter, okay, so it's not necessarily only one parameter, okay, even at one time we can vary two or more parameters. Okay, so the root locus method can also can investigate the effect of varying two or more parameter to a system. Okay, let's say the characteristic has two parameter. Okay, for example, we have a characteristic of equation like this. Okay, let's say there are two parameter that we are interested to vary. One of them is alpha, another one is beta. So you can utilize a root locus also to plot the root locus because of the variation in these two parameter. Okay, a root locus can be plotted for the first parameter, okay, and then another root locus can be plotted for the second parameter. Okay, the only thing we need to do in sequence, okay, plot the root locus for the first parameter first, and then after that we plot the second root locus for the variation of the second parameter. Okay, if you have three parameter for example, and then maybe you need three root locus, okay, to draw in sequence. Okay, let's say an example here, we have a characteristic equation like this, s to the power of 3 plus s to the power of 2 plus beta multiplied by s plus alpha, which is equal to 0. So if you look at this equation, there are two parameter, which is beta and alpha. Okay? And of course, in order for you to plot the root locus for the beta, you need to make the beta become the multiplier. Okay, so what you can do, you can divide this beta S with all the other term here, okay, which is this one, and then this one will divide by itself, will become one, okay, so you have the equation like this, okay. The only thing with this equation, you still have alpha here, which is unknown, okay, so because of this, you still cannot draw the root locus for this one, because you don't know where is the poles, right, okay. And then from this equation, what you need to do, okay, from this equation, okay, if we move the one to this side, it will become negative, and then we bring this here, will become negative s to the power of 3, negative s to the power of 2, negative alpha, and then if beta we equate it equal to 0, what will happen? Basically, this equation will become 0. Okay, so we have this equation become 0. Is it right? Okay, this equation, if you let beta equal to 0, basically you have this one will equal to 0. Okay, and now with this equation, okay, you can arrange this equation so that the alpha will become multiplier. Okay? Okay, just divide with s to the power of 3 and s to, plus s to the power of 2, where this one become 1, and then this one become like this. Okay? The only thing, this one, we can factor them. Okay? It become s to the power of 2 multiplied by s plus 1. Okay? So, when you have alpha become the multiplier like this, now you can use this equation to plot the root locus, okay, when you vary the alpha from 0 to infinity. Tak, sekarang ni kita just let the beta equal to 0 first, okay, we let the beta equal to 0. Kalau kita tak buat beta sebagai 0, maksudnya you akan always ada dua parameter, sebab nanti kalau tidak di sini pun akan appear beta. Jadi selagi itu you tak boleh draw the root locus. Okay? That's why here we need to make the beta equal to 0 so that in this equation there is no beta anymore, and then when we arrange as a multiplier, okay, of the alpha, basically we can, there is no beta here, so we can plot the root locus for the alpha. Okay? So with this equation, okay, basically you can start plotting the root locus. Okay, from this equation, how many poles we have? Okay, we have 3 poles. Okay, 2 poles are located at s equal to 0. So ini ada double ni. Okay, and then the other poles is located at s equal to minus 1. And then we don't have any 0. Okay, we don't have any 0. So we have 2 poles here, and then we have 2 poles here, and the other pole is here, 3 poles. And now you can start drawing, sketching the root locus on the real axis. Okay, because there are 2 here, so actually there is a segment here, but since they are overlapping, so the segments become just a dot there. Okay, from the first root to the second root. Okay, and then that's why after this there is no segment, and then this is the third roots, and then from the third root there will no more root that we have, so this one will go to infinity. And then with this system, since we have 3 poles, okay, that's why we will have 3 locus. Okay, we will have 3 locus. Okay, and since we don't have any zeros, all the locus will end up at infinity. So there are 3 asymptote. Okay, so for the 3 asymptote, basically you can find the location of the asymptote. Okay, The location of the asymptote is basically, if you calculate, basically the summation of the poles. So 0 plus 0 plus negative 1, okay, which become negative 1. And then you don't have 0 minus 0. Okay, so you have negative 1 and then divided by a number of pole minus number of 0. So that is 3. So basically negative 1 over 3. So that is the location of the center of the asymptote, which may be somewhere here. And then since you have 3 asymptotes, so if 3, easily basically one of them is 180 degree, the other one is 60 degree, okay, the other one is minus 60 degree. Okay, that when you have 3 asymptotes. So because of that, here if you calculate the breakaway point, you will find one of the breakaway point is located at the origin. Okay, because the segment is there. It come out from the poles and then it meets another locus. Okay, so the other one also come out from here and then it immediately meet and then it break away. So one of them break away this downward, one of them is upward. Okay, the only thing, because we have asymptote in this direction, okay, and then we have asymptote in this direction, that's why this one is following the asymptote and this one is following the asymptote that way. This is not a circle actually. Actually just a curve and then after that follow a straight line of the asymptote. Similarly with this. Okay? The one to this side is just following the asymptote, okay, in the angle of 180 degree. Okay? So that is the root locus when we vary the alpha. If you look at the alpha, okay, the root locus of the alpha, can we get the range of the alpha where the system becomes stable? Because when alpha is equal to 0, two of the root are located here and one of the root is located here. Okay, so that case the system is marginally stable. And then when we increase the alpha slightly, maybe it become here, one of the roots, another root may be somewhere here, and then another root may be somewhere here. What is the state of the system? Is it stable or not stable?
Not stable?
It is not stable, because two of the roots are located on the right-hand side of the S-plane. Okay? In fact, if you increase the alpha, even you increase until infinity, it also will be unstable. Okay? So for this case, actually, the alpha never become a stable system. Okay? There is no value of alpha that will make the system stable. Since you need to plot the root locus for the beta, okay, we need to pick the alpha a value, okay? Of course, if you have the, if this one, this parameter can and go into a stable area, maybe we select a point where it is stable, which is better, okay? But anyhow, if we couldn't do in the first parameter, never mind, because we still have the second parameter where we can adjust. Okay, the only thing here is that we need to select the value of alpha so that we can solve this one. Okay, let's say we just choose the alpha value when the roots become here, alpha 1. Okay, one of them is here, the second one is here, and then the third one is here. We select that value of alpha. Okay, so when we select that point as the root for selecting the alpha, okay, we will get the value for alpha 1. Okay, The only thing here is it does not show the value here, the location here, the scale here, so we do not know really what is the value of alpha. Let's say we know the value of alpha is a constant, okay? So when we select these roots, okay, from alpha, okay, what happened? Now we have a constant value for alpha. Actually, you can know the value of alpha 1 here when you know the position of this root, and then you find the distance, okay, the distance from all the roots, okay, you can find the what is the alpha 1, okay, and then from there when you know what is the value of the alpha 1, okay, basically now this root actually, because when the alpha is known as a constant, now you can plot this equation, you can sketch the root locus for this equation, okay, because once you know the alpha here, you can find the roots here, right, okay, and if we find the roots here from this equation, basically the roots is similar with this alpha 1 location. So that basically will become the poles in the root locus of beta. Okay? You see, this is A1, this is A1. This is A1, this is A1, and this is A1, and this is A1. Okay? So when we select the value for alpha here, that will dictate the pole for the beta. Okay? So that is the point. Okay? And now, with this equation, basically, we have the same number of poles because this is s to the power of 3. So we will have 3 poles. Right? Okay? The only thing here, in this equation, we have 1, 0. Okay? 1, 0, which is located at s equal to 0. So there is a 0 there, the circle there. So because we have 3 poles and 1, 0, so we can start sketching the root locus on the real roots, a real axis. Okay? So this is the first root, this is the second root, so there should be a segment there. Okay? The only thing, this is the poles, this is 0, so the locus come out from here and then go into this 0. Okay? And then if we calculate the asymptote from this equation, okay, maybe we will get the asymptote center somewhere here. You can calculate from this, the poles and 0 here. Okay? I think it's somewhere around here, the asymptote center. And then since the difference between the number of poles minus the number of zeros is equal to 2, so we have 2 asymptotes. When you have 2 asymptotes, basically one of them is going up, the other one is going down. And then from here, you can calculate the angle of departure. Okay? And if you calculate, maybe the angle of departure is somewhere like that. Maybe almost 180 degrees. And basically from there, the root locus will go following the angle of departure. And then when it's almost come close to the asymptote, it will follow the asymptote. One is going up, then the other is going down. Okay? So this is the root locus of the beta. Okay? This is the root locus of the beta. And the root locus of the beta will change if you change the value of alpha. For example, if you let the alpha, the pole will be same as this one. Okay, which is one at negative 1, and then the other one at 0, 2 of them at 0, okay, and then you will have the 0 located at 0 as well, and then the root log curve of the beta will be different, okay, because the starting impulse is located differently. Okay, now with this root locus, okay, you can choose the location of the roots, okay, because when you vary the beta, when beta is equal to zero, the roots is located here, 1, 2, and 3, okay. If you increase the value of the beta, maybe one of the root will become here, the other root will become here, and then the other root maybe will become here, okay. If you increase further, maybe one of the root will become here, and then one of the root will become here, and then the other root may be somewhere here. Okay? So in this case, for example, if you are required to get a stable system, basically you need to find, you need to get a roots which is located somewhere after the imaginary axis, okay, which is maybe somewhere here or somewhere here, okay, and the other root we find it somewhere here. It's showing that we can utilize the root locus to vary two variables. In fact, if we vary two variables like this, it is more advantages, because for example, if the first parameter, okay, does not allow us to get a stable system, okay, still we can vary the second parameter so that we can get a stable system. Similarly also, if you have the specification, maybe based on the percentage overshoot or damping ratio, okay, you can also determine the location of your roots. Okay. Okay. Bila you ada poles dekat sini, bila you ada complex pole, kan hari itu saya nyatakan, kita dapat ini because kita select alpha kat sini. Bila kita decide alpha, let's say mungkin the alpha equal to 20, katakan kat sini. Alpha alpha 1 tu, parameter yang kita vary itulah. Kalau kita decide, kita pilih alpha equal to 20 contohnya. Mungkin dia punya location kat sini. Okay. Bila yang ini location kat sini, bila kita select untuk yang ini, bila kita masukkan kat sini, basically dia akan jadi pole for the beta. Jadi maksudnya the selection of the alpha one, the alpha punya value dekat sini akan dictate kedudukan of the alpha one as the pole for the beta. This is example of welding head controls. A welding machine require an accurate control system for positioning the welding head. Okay, and given the specification, okay, the first specification is the steady state error, ESS, for a RAM input. Okay, input dia adalah RAM. RAM basically is 1 over S square. Okay, the input. Cuma given the steady state error for a RAM input should be less or equal than 35% of the input slope. Okay. And then it is given also the requirement, the damping ratio zeta of dominant roots should be greater or equal than 0.707. Okay. Yang ini sebenarnya basically equivalent to theta, equivalent to 45 degree. Okay, theta is less than 45 degree. And then the third specification is given. Okay, the settling time, okay, with the 2% criterion should be less than or equal to 3 seconds. And you are given a system like this. There are two loops. The GS basically is K1 divided by S divided by S plus 2, and then the feedback H1S basically is equal to K2 multiplied by S. And here it is given the input is a ramp input, so ramp input basically the RS is equal to A divided by S square. Okay, this is because it is say as a ramp input, it's not a unity, right? Because if unity, the A is equal to 1, but if you just say a ramp input, basically it should be A divided by S square. Of course, from the block diagram here, we need to get the transfer function first. And before getting the transfer function for the whole system, you need to solve first for the inner loops transfer function. So the inner loop transfer function, basically maybe we can write as G2, S is equal to G divided by 1 plus, because this is minus, multiply 1 plus G multiplied by H1S. Okay? And then you substitute the GS and also the HS1 in this equation, and then simplify the equation. Okay, you get the equation like this. Okay? Which is equal to K1 divided by S divided by S plus 2 plus K1 multiplied by K2. And then once we already simplify this one to just become one block. Okay, now you can simplify the outer loops to get the overall transfer function. So the overall transfer function is basically G2 for this simplified block divided by 1 plus, because this is minus, G2 multiplied by HS. The only thing HS here is equal to 1. So just multiply with 1 here. And then we replace the G2 inside this equation and simplify it. We get the transfer function will become K1 divided by S multiplied by S plus 2 plus K1 multiplied by K2 and then plus K1. Okay? So this is the transfer function of your system. Okay, from this transfer function, maybe you can get the characteristic equation from the denominator. The only thing before we proceed, we need to get the region for the desired root location. Okay, from the specification that are given, from the three specification. Okay, so you need to determine the region for the desired root location from the specification. First specification that is given is the steady state error, where the steady state error with the ramp input should be less than or equal to 35%. Okay, so the only thing we need to get the equation of the steady state error first. We know the steady state error basically is equal to limit t approaching infinity for the function of e as a function of t. Okay, or this one equal to limit s approaching 0, s multiplied by e as a function of s. Okay, the e is basically the error, and the error is basically is equal to rs minus ys. Maybe this one, ys is equal to the transfer function ts multiplied by rs. And then after that, we can simplify this. It will become 1 minus ts, and then the whole thing multiplied by rs. Just now, we have already calculated the transfer function, so you can put the transfer function here, the ts. And then, we have given that the input is a ramp input, which is A over S square. And then this one, okay, maybe one of the S here will cancel out with the S here. Okay. And this one, maybe we can simplify, become like this. Kena ada bracket ke? Saya rasa mungkin ada kena ada bracket kat luar ni. Oh, tidak. Ini memang macam ni. Sebenarnya kalau you simplify ini, equation ini, okay, basically you akan dapat at the end ini over yang ini tadi, okay. Dan the S ini nanti dia S yang ini tadi yang jadi ke atas dia akan cancel out dengan one of the S di sini, okay. Jadi the equation di sini adalah right. Okay. Mungkin you boleh balik cuba sendiri this equation. Okay, kalau you selesaikan, you akan dapat seperti ini. Okay, now sekarang bila you take the limit s approaching 0, okay, you boleh gantikan all the s with 0. Okay, and then basically after that you simplify the equation, you get a divided by a multiplied by 2 plus k1 multiplied by k2, and then the whole thing divided by k1. So this is the steady state error. Cuma tadi kita is given that the steady state error in the specification should be less than 35%. Okay, jadi kita boleh tulis sebagai ini. The steady state error ni tadi should be less than or equal to 0.35a. This is similar as 35%. If it is 100%, it will be equal to a, right? So that's why if 35% basically is 0.35a. So because of this, the a and a can cancel out, and then we have the equation here, which is just relating the k1 to k2. And then if we rearrange this equation, basically we will get the k2 should be less than or equal to 0.35 multiplied by k1 minus 2 divided by k1. So this is the relation, one of the relation between k2 to k1 that we should fulfill. Okay, later on we check this one, we use this relation to check whether the k1 that k2 that we obtain fulfilling this criteria or not. Okay, and then another specification which is given, that the zeta should be greater than 0.707. The only thing we know that the zeta is equal to cos theta. So basically from here, basically the theta should be less than or equal to r cos of 0.707. Okay, that mean the theta should be 45 degree angles, should be less than. Okay, if you know this, basically you can plot, this is theta, this is the angle theta, 45 degree. Okay, since the theta should be less than 45 degree, so it will cover the area on the side of this line. Okay, so basically if you want to choose the root should be in this area in order to fulfill this angle, this damping ratio criteria. And then another specification that are given is that the settling time should be less than or equal to 3 seconds. The only thing we know, the equation of the settling time for the 2% criterion, which is 4 divided by zeta omega n. So from here we know that zeta multiplied by omega n should be greater or equal to 4 divided by 3. Okay, and you can draw a line, okay, representing the value of the zeta multiplied by omega n here, 4 divided by 3, which is somewhere here, 1 point something. Okay, you can draw a line here. Okay, since you say here should be greater or equal, so in the area in front of this line, on the left hand side of this line. Okay, so with these two specifications, you find an overlap area which is shaded here. That means later on, when you want to choose the location of the roots, okay, the roots should lie in this area, in order the system to fulfill the specification. Okay, if you choose somewhere here, it will be out of the specification. If you choose somewhere here, it is out of specification as well. Okay, and beside that, later on you need to check whether the k1 and k2 that you decided are fulfilling this relationship. Okay? So that is how we design the control system. Okay? That's why now we need the root locus, so that we want to see how the root locus will travel, whether it will travel going inside this area or not, so that we can choose the location of the roots in this area. Sambung balik. Okay?